Good morning, and good morning, and welcome to the 10th meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2024. We have apologies this morning from Stephanie Callaghan, so Stuart McMillan will be attending in her place, and Stuart will join us slightly later on. The main item on our agenda is the evidence session on the Additional Support for Learning inquiry, and this is the fifth and final session on this inquiry, which will consider how the Education Additional Support for Learning Scotland Act 2004 has been implemented and how it is working in practice some 20 years on. And today we're going to hear from the Cabinet Secretary and her officials. And we've been focusing on three themes throughout the inquiry: the implementation of the presumption of mainstreaming, the impact of COVID-19 on additional support for learning, and the use of remedies as set out in the Act. So can I welcome this morning Jenny Gilruth, the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills, Claire Henderson, Team Leader Supporting Learners from the Scottish Government, and Laura Meikle, Head of the Support and Wellbeing Unit at the Scottish Government. Good morning and welcome to all of you. I would now like to invite the Cabinet Secretary to make an opening statement. Cabinet Secretary, you have up to 3 minutes. Thank you.
Convener, good morning. I welcome the opportunity to contribute to the committee's post-legislative inquiry on the Additional Support for Learning Act. And we are now 20 years on since the introduction of the Additional Support for Learning legislation, and our education offer in Scotland looks, in many ways, radically different to that which existed back in 2004. But for many young people, and for their families, things have not progressed in the way that they should have, nor at the pace that they should have. And I am acutely aware of what that means for young people and their families' experiences in Scotland's schools, particularly given the substantive increase in learners with additional support needs in recent years. These young people are not an add-on. They are part of the inclusive nature of Scotland's education system. So we need a whole systems approach to better ensure that inclusivity is experienced by all. The review of Additional Support for Learning, published by Angela Morgan back in 2020, primarily focused on the implementation of the 2004 Act. And that review concluded that there is no fundamental deficit in the principle and policy intention of the ASL legislation or of the substantial guidance accompanying it. The challenge lies in translating that intention into practice. As members will know, the Scottish Government, in partnership with COSLA, responded to the Morgan Review, accepting all of the recommendations. We set out a clear action plan detailing 76 actions to be taken at national and local level to address the challenges raised and to support the necessary shift in culture, leadership and values across our education system. We are currently halfway through that action plan, with 39 of the 76 actions marked as delivered. And as my officials have indicated in writing to the committee, the next detailed progress report is due to publish in the coming weeks, and I look forward to engaging with members and indeed Parliament on the progress. The ASL Project Board are focused on reducing the fragmentation of ASL policy, and work has been undertaken to map how ASL policy links to wider education, health and social care policies to ensure that we work across boundaries to deliver better support. We're also undertaking a review of the external information shared on ASL policy through a range of different platforms to refresh content and to provide enhanced and consistent information across the system. Progress towards an inclusive leadership approach for ASL policy is underway, with ADES incorporating this initiative into their collaborative improvement programme. Education Scotland have also launched their inclusion, wellbeing and equalities professional learning framework with direct input from the teaching profession. Our working group have also developed a professional learning framework for support staff, which includes a range of learning and development resources. Children and young people, parents and carers, and the wider profession are all critical to the delivery of the improvement we need to make, and we continue to work in partnership with the Young Ambassadors for Inclusion, the ESL Network, and parents and carers' representatives across our stakeholder groups. Convener, I do want to put on the record the achievements of our pupils with additional support needs, which are many and varied. And it's worthwhile saying that the attainment gap between mainstream and special school pupils with ASN and with no ASN achieving one or more NAT5 equivalent by the time they leave school has reduced by more than half. I think it's important to recognise the success and also to be mindful of the wider educational landscape, which I know the committee will be. Future education reform, I think, is going to affect all learners with additional support needs, just as it affects those who don't have an additional support need. And undoubtedly, as the committee has heard, the pandemic has also impacted on the pace of improvement, as it has on many other aspects of young people's lives. Convener, before I conclude, I want to touch briefly on the statistics which published yesterday from the government, which included troubling new evidence in relation to attendance. Now, absence is one of the range of post-pandemic challenges, I think, facing our schools. But the data which published yesterday again reinforces a renewed need for a drive across central and local government to ensure improved outcomes for all of our young people. We will continue to work in partnership to deliver the recommendations of the ESL Action Plan by March of 2026. But fundamentally, as Angela Morgan stated in her review, we cannot continue to view additional support for learning as a minority area or in a separate silo within the framework of Scottish education. And it is in that spirit that I look forward to any suggestions and indeed questions committee members may have today.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'm going to move to questions from members now. And the first kick-off this morning is Liam Kerr, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Over the last few weeks, this committee's heard really powerful testimony and a lot of detail on some of the challenges facing our people in this area. Cabinet Secretary, when you've reviewed the official reports of this, is there anything specific that's jumped out as particularly concerning for you and that you intend to address it almost like a first 100 days after our report comes out?
Yes, well, I think, first of all, I very much welcome the committee's inquiry, given that we're halfway through, of course, the ESL Action Plan, and we'll be updating that in the coming weeks. And we intend to learn from the outputs from the committee to inform that process. There have been a number of points, actually, the committee has looked at that I have been considering in recent weeks. I think I want to kind of touch on some of those, actually, if I may, convener. So some of the evidence the committee took in relation to funding of ASL, I thought was very important, particularly in relation to the commentary from Audit Scotland, who talked about the approach that's adopted at the current time, not just being a local authority question. And I think when I think about ASN, we often think about it in an education silo, and it's for education budgets to mop up that need. It's not. We need to be more mindful of different budgetary requirements and how we can be more holistic in that provision so that our young people are better supported. And I know that point was also made, I think, by the Royal College of Speech and Language Therapists, who talked about how we could do that more holistically and not having a fight over funding, which I'm very mindful of, because this is about fundamentally how we can get it right for every child. And so if we use GRFEC really as our measure here, we need to, I think, better reflect that and how that funding works on the ground. And I know the committee has taken evidence from how that can be fragmented in relation to delivery. So those were two examples of things that jumped out at me in relation to funding in particular. But there were a number of other areas, I think, that the committee has heard from in relation to the design of school buildings, for example, and how that can impact on additional support needs. And more broadly, the way in which the pandemic has changed our education system. And I'm very mindful that in the coming weeks, as the committee knows, I will need to formally respond to the Hayward Review. And I think that we need to be mindful of the increase in additional support needs in that context, mindful of the challenges in relation to behaviour right now. The challenge right now, as Mr Kerr will know, in relation to attendance. All of these factors since COVID have compounded, I think. And fundamentally, to compare the legislation that would, you know, pass back in 2004 to where we are now, completely different educational offering. And therefore, I think, as Cabinet Secretary, I'm very keen to hear the committee's views on the evidence it's taken, and that we can better reflect that, I think, in our updated ASL Action Plan, which we have made progress of, but I know the committee will want to talk to some of the specifics on what that looks like in practice.
I'm grateful. Specifically on the budgetary requirements and silos and things, I think it was a particularly interesting part of your answer there. That does need address, and I think the committee will agree with that. But who has the responsibility here for driving that forward? So you talked about a whole systems approach in your opening remarks. Who is going to lead that, and who has the responsibility for addressing these issues? Is it the Scottish Government, or is it going to be local authorities, or indeed another body?
Well, I think it's got to be addressed in partnership, and that's why the Additional Support for Learning Action Plan has been a joint endeavour between Scottish Government and with COSLA, much like actually our work in relation to behaviour. And I should say, Convener, that tomorrow Isagrabus will meet to talk about the issues associated with attendance. And I know the committee might want to look at that issue in more detail, because attendance across the country looks different in different parts of the country. I think it's important to understand that local variation, which is why COSLA have to play a role in this. But I accept, as Cabinet Secretary, government needs to provide a leadership role too. So in relation to additional support needs, I think that joint partnership working in relation to the ESL Action Plan is well understood. If the committee has different views on that, though, I'm happy to listen to what those might be.
Grateful. Convener.
Thank you. That was quite succinct there, and I'm hoping Michelle Thompson is ready and online now. We come to Michelle Thompson.
Firstly, apologies that I can't be in the room. I need to leave a little earlier and I didn't want to disturb the flow of the meeting. I want to ask a framing question, if you like, that'll help support some of the other questions coming later. We know that we've had increased inputs into the education system generally, average spend per pupil for primary and secondary, more classroom assistants and so on. And yet we still have a perception of lack of support for pupils with ASN. Now, I'm very mindful, as you are, of the increased demand, but I'd appreciate your reflections on why that perception persists despite the increased inputs over a long period of time. Thank you.
So I think Convener Michelle Thompson touches on a really important issue. I can, if the committee wishes, rehearse all the statistics I have at my fingertips in relation to government investment in education. But I think the substantive point the member makes is why, given that there is additionality in relation to spend per pupil, and actually in relation to pupil support assistance, again, data on which published yesterday, why is the need so great? So part of it relates into the way that we measure additional support needs. The committee will be aware we changed the way in which we measured additional support needs back in 2010. So that's led to some increase. There are other external factors driving an increase in relation to the number of additional support needs pupils at the current time. For example, I think just over 5% is accounted for by EAL pupils. So that's helping to drive an increase in that space additionally. And there are wider factors for that increase that the committee may be aware of. I think more generally, as one head teacher put it to me, and I think I may have made this point to committee previously last year, during the pandemic, when other services stepped back, schools stepped up. And school, I think, is now filling a void that other services have historically filled. And I think that is part of the growing feeling that the system is under an inordinate amount of pressure. Whereas in the past, even 10, 15 years ago, schools were very focused on providing education. Our schools, and I know committee will know this because members will spend a lot of time in their own constituencies visiting schools. Schools are providing services now that 5, 10 years ago they just didn't provide. So I think part of the pressure is that broader approach of the role of school education or the school itself providing community support in some instances that it didn't in the past.
Well, thank you very much for that response, and I think you fairly reflect the new environment post-pandemic, if you like. So my follow-on question is, given that that perception of a lack of resources persists, and for very good reason, have you set out what actions as a result are you going to be able to undertake so that people can start to see that things are in train and manage that perception?
So I think there are a range of things we can do in government, and I suppose this speaks goes back to some extent to the point that Mr Kerr was speaking about, local, national, where does responsibility sit? So one of the things we can do in government is we can ring fence. And the committee might want to push me on this point, but of course, in recent times, the government has taken, I think, a principled stance in ring-fencing teacher numbers and teacher funding for that as well. And because of that additional £145 million, the statistics that published yesterday show an increase in relation to pupil support assistance, because that additionality is also for pupil support assistance. So there are actions that government can take centrally to protect funding for certain areas, and there might be others that disagree with that, but I think actually that's really important in terms of yes, protecting inputs but also outputs, because we know if we have more staff in the system we can help to improve outcomes for our children and young people. So that's one of the actions that we can take. More broadly, as I've alluded to, I think in my response to in my opening commentary, actually the additional support for learning action plan, I think, is a good, tells a good story of progress we have made, and Laura may want to talk to some of the specifics. We're not, I think, where we should be. Part of that is because of the pandemic. However, we have been able to make key progress in a number of different areas. And I think it's important to recognise that. And the final point, I suppose, I would touch on. I've mentioned educational reform today. The committee will know that in the coming weeks and months, I will bring forward legislation on a range of new bodies that are going to exist to replace the current examinations body, and also Education Scotland with the inspectorate function coming out. We invite committee members to consider the role of these bodies in supporting our young people with additional support needs. I know the committee has taken evidence, for example, in terms of the support available from Education Scotland at the current time. But I suppose I ask the question, in this new post-pandemic educational world that we're living in, with all of these challenges, could that support be better provided? And I think there is opportunity through, for example, the Centre for Teaching Excellence to deliver some of that. I might bring Laura in on some of the specifics of the ESL Action Plan.
Absolutely. So the Morgan Review obviously focused on what children, young people and parents and carers' experiences were of additional support for learning. As Ms Gilruth has already highlighted, we know that in terms of achievement and attainment, there are improvements in that area, but the challenge remains that children, young people and their families are having challenging experiences in relation to additional support for learning. And that is the fundamental focus of the Morgan Review, but it then also is naturally then the focus of our work on the ESL Action Plan specifically. And the point about how do we convey what it is that we are doing and the changes that we are seeking to make, that purposefully that is why ministers have asked us to report on a regular basis about the progress being made against the actions of the ESL Action Plan in a way that's very, very public, in order to be accountable but also demonstrate that we are seeking to make that change. As I say, we can certainly comment on specifically on actions if the committee wishes us to do so during the course of this morning, but I think that might be helpful in terms of why it is that we're acting in the way that we are in relation to the action plan. I hope that's helpful.
Thank you very much. Thank you, convener.
Thank you, Michelle Thompson. Can I now bring in Willie Rennie, please?
I think your approach to this morning is good. I think, you know, it's difficult. It's really bad just now, I think. I'm really worried, reading the written evidence, probably even more so than the oral evidence that we had, it's pretty tough. You know, a lot of people are really feeling it. Are you concerned that we are in danger of pitting pupils with additional support needs against other pupils because of the huge demands on teacher and assistant time that inevitably leads others to lose out? Are you worried about the atmosphere that's been created in the classroom, with some losing out as in a drive, quite rightly, to get inclusion? Are you concerned that that's happening?
I take the member's point. I suppose the question he asks is the presumption of mainstreaming the right approach?
Not so much. It's more really the... I'm not asking that. Okay. I'm just saying is... You know, I mean, I've got one quote here, which is, this is from a teacher. Inclusion currently looks like whole classes being left with little to no support, while the teacher de-escalates situations and supports individuals to regulate. Now, that touches over into the whole behaviour issues. But,
yeah, it does.
But the two are quite closely connected. I'm just worried that situation, if left to fester, could create more of a division.
Yeah, I mean, I think there are undoubtedly challenges here. So that Mr Rennie touches on behaviour, and of course the committee will know there are strong links between additional support needs and challenges in relation to behaviour, and we need to be mindful of that. We also need to be mindful that children with an additional support need are far more likely to be excluded. And when we have an inclusive education system, I think there is a challenge there. I think more broadly, though, the challenge in schools is well documented, and he cites evidence from a teacher, I'm sure we all know teachers, I certainly do, who would quote some of the challenge here. Fundamentally, though, supporting additional support needs is the responsibility of every teacher in Scotland. They should be trained to and supported to respond to those young people. I think there is a challenge there at the current time. I think that additional support needs as a measure sometimes can be quite monolithic, but if you delve into it, there are a range of different needs that sit behind that 37%, I think it is currently, we have of young people with an additional support need. So that measure sometimes covers things that underneath it might be low level in terms of the additional support that's needed, and I think we should be mindful of that too. The other thing to be mindful of is that some schools are supporting, in fact many schools are supporting our children with additional support needs very, very well. And I was thinking last week, ahead of today's committee appearance, about a school I visited in Dundee, Craigie High School, who are doing some fantastic work with their pupil equity funding to support children with additional support needs. And it is that holistic, inclusive approach that secondary school has adopted that's really changing outcomes for those young people. So I accept the challenge, but I also know there are some schools that are responding to that challenge differently. So perhaps there's a role here, and again, this is where I question the role in future of bodies like Education Scotland to exemplify good practice, but to share it across the board. Where there is challenge, there are opportunities as well. And I think people equity funding, we have examples of SAC funding as well being used to really provide that additionality and provide that support that's needed in schools. I think more broadly, though, that there is a challenge here that I don't shy away from. But the alternative to that is, I think, to move away from the presumption of mainstreaming. And I don't think anyone round the table this morning, convener, would be in favour of that, from all that I've seen from the evidence that the committee has taken.
So are you indicating that perhaps, of course, resources are part of it because you've identified a number of different funds, but there is something beyond money that can change in schools to make things better?
Yes.
And yeah. So we know that, do we? And why is that not kind of been rolled out? Why has that not been embraced in the way that we'd want it?
So I think the committee took evidence on this and it was focused on school culture, and I think that's part of it, how you can support that holistic school culture. And right now, I suppose schools, it goes back to the point that Michelle Thompson was making. Schools are dealing with lots of different things. So they have to raise attainment, look at our PISA stats. These are the questions that committee members will be putting to me before Christmas. We've got to respond to attendance as well. We've got real challenges with persistent non-attendance, which I would like to come back to at some point. But we also need to support our children and young people, and we weren't very good at doing that historically. You know, when I was at school not that long ago, although I will be 40 this year, many children with additional support needs would be removed from classes I assign because they would be seen as a problem, seen as a challenge, and they would be put elsewhere. And I worry that the current public debate is moving us back into that space. I don't think that's where we want to go. I do think teachers want support. They need that wraparound provision. Part of that support is the investment we've put into pupil support assistance, and I'm pleased that that's held this year. We've increased the numbers of pupil support assistance. I know Mr. Rennie might have a follow-up question on that in relation to specialisms of staff, because I am mindful of that too. But I think we have a strong and inclusive education system in Scotland. That was one of the strengths that came out of the national discussion that published last year. So it's something we should celebrate. But I don't deny the tension here just now at the current time. And part of that, I think we all need to reflect, is post-pandemic and this malaise across the system, whether that be on attendance or attainment or additional support needs, is felt in a number of other jurisdictions. I know the Welsh are struggling with very similar challenges and down south very similar.
I know it's got worse since the pandemic, there's no doubt about that, but it was there before. The stresses were being felt quite considerably before that. And I suppose my other question relates to where we draw that line and whether we're getting it right about who's in mainstream and who's in a specialist environment. Do you think we've got the plan for the number and type of specialist places right? Do you think that balance is appropriate? And have we got sufficient specialisms?
So are you talking about specialist schools?
Specialist environment, specialist schools, specialist places. Do you think we've got that line in an appropriate place?
So looking at some of the evidence the committee has taken on this, no, I'm not convinced we are at the current time. I think we need to reflect that in the ASL Action Plan update. And officials and I were discussing that earlier today and on Monday as well. I think right now, and we may come on to this, convener, in relation to the role of the tribunal. Parents often feel they have to fight against the system to have their voices heard and to have their young person diagnosed, for example, and I don't think that currently reflects, I suppose, the intention of the 2004 Act. So no, I think we need to recalibrate that balance post-pandemic. And because things have got more difficult, undoubtedly, they were challenging before the pandemic, it has compounded. But I was struck by some of the evidence the committee has taken on this, particularly in relation to the role of the tribunal. So we will be mindful of that in response to the ASL Action Plan, but I'm also keen to hear the committee's recommendations on this too.
I was quite struck by the speech and language representative, therapist representative, where he was saying that the current model isn't working, that he believes that because, as you quite rightly identified, additional support needs has got a wide spectrum of things, and you can't expect teachers to know absolutely everything about every single specialism, so you need experts to come in to help you with those pupils, but then you gain knowledge from that. But he was saying that their involvement in the class is much less than it used to be. Do you think that kind of specialist input from what you've seen, is at the right level just now?
From what I've seen, well, it's difficult to say because, of course, as Mr. Rennie will know, it will look different in his constituency than it might in other parts of the country. And I think one of the things I grapple with as Education Secretary is the variance across the system that we see school by school, local authority by local authority. So it's quite difficult to give a monolithic answer to say, yes, it's not good enough and we need to improve it. I mean, I broadly would support that, but let's get into some of the detail here, because in some schools there might be excellent speech and language provision. In other areas there might have been reductions, and we need to reflect that in government and ensure actually that if that has been the decision of the local authority, well, where's the support then for the children and young people there? One of the things I was struck by as well last year, and committee will recall, we published data on speech and language delays actually in some of our youngest, so 0 to 2, and our poorest citizens from the lowest socioeconomic backgrounds. There are real challenges post-pandemic with these young people coming back into formal education, whether that's ELC and then progressing obviously into primary school. So I think you touched on a really important point. What we have been able to do specifically in relation to speech and language is to put investment into Education Scotland. So we have a team now that are working to support that at national level, and they go out and they can provide that support that Mr. Rennie speaks to. But there's only so many of them, and we need to upskill, I think, and support the profession, but also we need to recognise the role of local government. So that goes to Mr. Kerr's point as well. This can't just be a government-only endeavour. I really want COSLA, for example, to be part of building the new Centre for Teaching Excellence. I want them to have buy-in in it. I think that could have an offer to the profession, but it could also give an offer, I think, to our young people with additional support needs.
Thanks very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rennie. And Pam Duncan-Clancy, I think you've got a supplementary in and around this theme.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. And good morning to your officials who've joined you. I just want to pick up on the point that you made earlier around parents. So I think what we've seen as a committee is a system in distress, staff being overworked, pupils not attending, as you've alluded to, and parents feel they're never done fighting. So some quotes, they said it's heartbreaking, the waiting is so frustrating, it's a minefield, so many children and families are being failed, and I wish these people making decisions could walk in my shoes. So can I ask Cabinet Secretary, what would you say to those parents and families today that whilst you yourself have said you've put additional resources in, what would you say to them when they say those things back?
So, look, no parent, no carer should be having to fight for rights that their children are entitled to under this Act, and they should have that support. So that is my starting point. And remember, as well as being Cabinet Secretary, I'm a constituency MSP, so I'm sure that you all receive constituency correspondence on these issues. I know I do in my local capacity. But at a national level, I think one thing I would want to reflect, some of the evidence the committee took in relation to the role of the tribunal, I think the tribunal should be the kind of backstop. That's the last place we want parents to end up. They shouldn't have to go there. There are a number of other remedies that are open to parents to consider in relation to how they can resolve challenges with their local authority on support for their child. So they can, first of all, make a complaint to the local authority. There's also the option of mediation. And finally, the option of independent adjudication. So before getting to that tribunal stage, there are a number of interventions that can be taken. And I think through the ASL Action Plan, there's opportunity for us to be clearer about those interventions, to make sure that parents know about those interventions, that they know about their rights, and that they shouldn't have to, you know, escalate, I suppose, to the tribunal, and we might come back to that. The Action Plan, though, I think, will help to improve everyone's understanding. But we need to, and also, I should say, there's, of course, the Section 70 opportunity for parents and carers to escalate it to me. That's very, very rare that that would happen, but it is an option open to parents and carers. But we don't want parents to have to go through that process because it's extraordinarily stressful. It's not good for the young person either. Actually, it'd be much better if we could resolve these issues at local authority level. So I will continue to work with COSLA on this, and as I alluded to, a meeting with them tomorrow as part of the Sagribus work, and we will undoubtedly touch on the ASL Action Plan too. Today. Apologies, today.
Thank you. I'm conscious.
Thank you, Pam. Cabinet Secretary, you spoke about that no one would disagree with the presumption of mainstreaming and in terms of that drive for inclusion. And again, you've just been mentioning the tribunal, but the tribunal in evidence to us has sort of challenged that, saying that an inclusive education for those who have additional support needs would be best served by the removal of a bias in favour of a particular type of education, so it's making something that's mainstreaming, and a bias of this type is the reverse of an inclusive approach. So I was wondering what your thoughts might be on that.
So I was quite struck by the evidence the committee took from the tribunal president on this. I mean, I think overall I would agree with the position that was set out. The legislation which was set out in relation to the presumption of mainstreaming predates the ASL Act, and obviously that enshrines in legislation the right to mainstream education for those with an additional support need. We did publish in 2019 revised guidance on the presumption to mainstream, and that guidance is very clear on the responsibilities for local authorities in weighing up their decision-making in relation to tribunals. But if there is any doubt, though, I think, about the suitability of mainstream provision, it is really the role of the local authority to use that legislation to weigh up the measures. I was quite taken with the evidence the committee took from the tribunal president, and I think we would seek to engage with her directly on this, particularly in relation to updating the ASL Act, because I talked to Ms Duncan Glancy about the range of options open to parents or carers before getting to that tribunal phase, and it feels as though there's a waiting towards the tribunal phase at the current time, which is out of sync with where we should be in relation to that option. So I think I would be keen to engage with the tribunal president directly on this point.
Okay. So the ASN tribunal did argue that the presumption of mainstreaming shouldn't be grounds also for refusing a placing request. Yeah. But also we heard from Matthew Kavanagh, who was from a specialist school, who stated that often it's a specialist setting that would be best suited for that mm-hmm. child. Mm-hmm. And much of my casework certainly is around the placing requests when the local authorities that are making decisions haven't even met or engaged
Indeed.
With the young person. So I was wondering what your thoughts might be around that.
Well, again, I think that is a matter for obviously the local authority in question and convener. I suppose I would reflect I receive similar correspondence as an MSP on these issues, and I think part of the challenge here is the points I was making to Ms Duncan Glancy about the options that are open to parents and carers. It is worthwhile saying we fund advocacy services to help work with parents to make them aware of their rights in this space, but I do think there's a bit of a cluttered landscape at the current time, and I think the ASL Action Plan will allow us to really pull together some of the advice for parents and carers so that they know what their rights are. But equally, we need to work with COSLA on this, with local authorities, because we don't want to get to that tribunal phase. There are a number of interventions that can be taken. Mediation, for example, is a really good way of resolving often some of the challenge here. So it shouldn't be that parents are having to escalate things to the tribunal process, causing them and their child, of course, a great deal of stress.
And we've also heard, or we're certainly aware of, some local authorities having growth. There's more specialist units, there you go, or bases, as some of them, because they've all got different terminology for them within the mainstream schools in terms of, and we've also heard about some of the challenges with the language that's used for people understanding. So do you think that the legislation is working given how schools are evolving to include these new environments?
I think schools have evolved, and I know of a number in my own constituency where there are DAS units, for example, and parents will opt to send their child to that school because they will presume that school has better provision for their child. So I think actually we need to be mindful of that at national level, because local authorities are responding to local needs in relation to additional support needs, and they are putting in that specialist provision. So I think, again, through the ASL Action Plan, there's opportunity for us to work with them. I don't want to dictate to local authorities, but I do see opportunity for us perhaps firming up some of the guidance here in relation to how that mainstream support might look. When I first started teaching a long time ago now, we used to have a department for support for learning, and we also had a behaviour support department. So there was a completely different approach to supporting additional support needs. We've had, over the course of a number of years, I think we've moved into I suppose ASM being included within how teachers support their children and young people, but we also need to recognise the role of pupil support assistants, be they behaviour support assistants or pupil support assistants, and that's why we protect that funding through the additionality that is currently ring-fenced.
And I suppose if parents and carers are aware of what's happening in the development in these schools, then there might be more understanding of the placing that they're...
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Or did you want to speak to
it? Yeah, I mean, I think the point that's made in relation to the understanding of different types of provision is very valid. The definition in the Additional Support for Learning Act of a special school includes a unit attached to a mainstream school. That might not be a very natural thing that any of us would, a conclusion that any of us would come to naturally without that specific understanding. So I think there are opportunities to confirm and clarify those things. We have an action under the ASL Action Plan which is about improving information and part of that and communication, and part of that is about making sure it is to improve that understanding. We don't want people to have that challenging time in understanding their rights, in understanding how they access their rights, and then what does the system actually look like and who does what where. That's quite important. It's obviously very important for everyone to be able to have a shared understanding of that, and so that's why we have that particular action around communication as well, which I hope will improve that as we continue to work on communication through that plan.
Thank you. Do you want to come in again? Is that you okay? No. You're fine. Thank you. Bill Kidd now, please.
Thank you very much, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, thanks for your replies. They're very useful to us. I'm going to have a wee ramble at the minute before I ask my question, if that's all right, because it's about the physical environment of education. You've already mentioned some elements of that. And 3 weeks ago, the committee explored how physical environments can contribute to inclusive education. So I'm going to three wee quotes here, if you don't mind, from the panel that we had then. Susie Martin from the National Autistic Society of Scotland said the trend towards super schools is potentially unhelpful and quite harmful, depending on what those super schools look like. The Govan Law Centre submission said it perplexes us as to why schools are becoming bigger, meaning more sensory and social stimuli to navigate. And Dr Lynn Binney of ADES told us that the design of buildings is often determined at local authority level through different approaches, perhaps involving professionals such as architects who might not always understand or know about the complex needs of the children that we see in the current system and project in the future of our buildings. So that's some of the quotes that we've had, which tend to suggest that the buildings that are replacing schools, new build schools, and even in the existing estate, sometimes the learning environment can be damaging for pupils with additional support needs. And we're just wondering how the Scottish Government is supporting, shall we say, local authorities to ensure that these schools will be suitable for all children.
So I thank Mr Kidd for his question. I looked at some of the evidence that the committee had taken on school design. I'm pretty sympathetic to it. I am a Fife MSP, and there are a number of large schools in the area of Fife that the local authority has decided that's the kind of approach they would like to education. I attended one of them. Two, actually, I think in Mr Rennie's constituency, very large schools, Madras and Bill Baxter, and in my own constituency, or just outside it rather, Leavenmouth Academy, which brought two schools together and also includes Fife College. We also have in Dunfermline a big campus with two secondary schools going into it and Fife College. So some local authorities take this approach, and whilst I think Ms Martin used the description super schools, that's not a description we would use. I think there are some schools in Scotland that are too big. I think they are too big for our children with additional support needs, but I think they are too big for our pupils and our staff, full stop. And what that means is that teachers don't get to know their children and young people in big schools. So if you think about Fife and the geography of that little area of Scotland, lots of little towns and villages coming together in a huge school, children become lost. And when we talk about challenges associated with behaviour, attainment, this is all about relationships and your teachers knowing their kids. I think we need to get some further advice in relation to school design, and I've asked officials for work on that via Scottish Futures Trust, who I think the committee have also written to on this point. Of course, we work with local authorities primarily to give them funding to help, because the buildings don't belong to us, they belong to local authorities. So we've given local authorities substantial amounts of funding in recent years to help improve the quality of the school estate. The design of the school estate, though, often comes from local authorities themselves, I think, as you heard from Hades. But some, in my experience, some architects are mindful of local needs and they will engage with parents and carers. They quite often engage with young people about the things they would like to see in their school. I suppose what I also might add into the mix in that, and I don't think the committee took evidence on this, but I have had a parliamentary question on it from one Kenny Gibson not so long ago now. And he raised a question with me around about open plan classrooms. And I think it's worthwhile considering how that can contribute to challenges in relation to learning and additional support needs. I see in many of the visits I undertake open plan classrooms, and sometimes it can work well. But I think often for some young people, it's extremely difficult to concentrate in those environments. And we need to be mindful of that when we're talking about challenges in other parts of our education system. So I'm very taken with the evidence the committee has heard in relation to school design, and we will certainly take this back to our work with COSLA and with Scottish Futures Trust. Of course, we have just announced the phase three of LEAP funding I announced in December, and we're working with the SFT on the next funding approach. So I know the committee has asked for a written update from the SFT, and I look forward to engaging with them on this too, because I think it is an important point.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much. And just on the back of that, the way that, I mean, obviously, as you say, the Scottish Government supports the local authorities by providing them with the funding in order to build these schools and design them and develop them. But yeah, as you say, they're then the local authorities' decision-making process. But does that mean that there isn't any overarching sort of approach to changing how these schools, which might not be beneficial to all the children, are designed, if you know what I mean?
Yeah, I might bring in Laura in relation to some of the opportunities here, but I think more broadly, Mr. Kidd asked a question about whether or not I can direct local authorities on how they build their schools. So I think that's going to create a bit of tension, Mr. Kidd. So probably a partnership approach, as most things we do in education has to be working with COSLA. I think the points the committee has taken on this are really important, because school building and actually the design of a learning place can impact on attainment, but particularly for children with additional support needs, it can be much more challenging for them. So where they learn is important. And I might bring in Laura just in relation to the code of practice.
Sure. There are opportunities in relation to learning environment. There are four factors within the statute of code of practice that are highlighted as potentially giving rise to additional support needs, and one of those is learning environment. And therefore, while we are doing our work under the ESL Action Plan to refresh the statutory guidance, which is ongoing at the moment, there are opportunities to draw the connections that Ms. Gilruth has highlighted around the importance of design of learning environment within that document, reflecting, I think, as has already been said, the sort of changing nature of children and young people's educational experiences in more recent times. We can certainly take that opportunity.
Yeah, that's very helpful. Thank you very much indeed.
A number of supplementary requests in on here. Can we go to Willie Rennie first, please?
This has been quite a good session so far, so I'm reluctant to go down this route. But I'm afraid your predecessor, John Swinney, was insistent that the new high school in Dunfermline was a combined one between St Columbus and Woodmill, and also included Fife College into the joint campus. So I absolutely agree with what your approach, but he drove that against some resistance locally. So I'm just wondering what's changed the policy on this, because he was for a one-stop shop, combining places together. There was resistance. Why have we now changed the approach?
I'm fairly certain that Fife Council had an input into that process.
Well, no, so it sure wasn't, they did, but John Swinney was insistent.
I think it was a partnership process. In my experience, it's not really the role of government. It's not a change of policy here today. What I've said is I've listened to the evidence taken from the committee in relation to additional support needs, and I think we need to better reflect it in our practice. So that might mean that we work with Scottish Futures Trust on providing clearer guidance on this issue in the future. And I've named a number of schools, including those in Mr. Rennie's constituency, one of which I attended, which I think are large schools, and we need to be careful about how large schools meet the needs of a cohort of young people who are different from other children and need different support, and therefore can often get lost in mainstream. We know this. So how does that work in a much larger school, particularly when some of these young people have come from very small rural areas of the country?
Okay, sorry.
Ruth Maguire, thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Just a quick follow-up, Cabinet Secretary. Is there no Scottish Government guidance on the design of school buildings? Is that what we're saying?
No, there is. It comes from Scottish Futures Trust. So they do set out a range of parameters in relation to school build design, and they work with local authorities on that. They also work to the passive house approach, so the schools are meant to be much more environmentally friendly. But in my experience, it's for the SFT to work with the local authority on the design spec itself.
Would those, I would have imagined for public buildings, equality impact assessments would be important?
Sorry, it might be helpful for me to add to this at this point. There is also there's a specific duty to consider accessibility under the Disability Strategies and Educational Records Act. And there is guidance available which is about ensuring accessibility of physical environment, curriculum and information provided for disabled pupils. Obviously, in the those duties are focused to pupils with disabilities. Mm. In the context that we work, we would apply that more widely in relation to additional support for learning. So there is guidance available on that specific point as well.
The guidance isn't just about the physical environment and physically accessing the building, it's about learning and...
Physical environment, curriculum and provision of information.
Okay.
It's already linked into the current code of practice, but again, it might be something we will highlight
That would be quite troubling if for the last number of years we've been building new schools that aren't meeting the needs of, in terms of learning, for a policy of inclusion of all pupils.
I think as has been indicated, we recognise that the design of schools has evolved over a number of years. The guidance that I'm referring to relates to an earlier period of time, and the statutory guidance that we have produced has already drawn those two things together. I think there are, as has been alluded, there is more that we can do in this space, and we will seek to do that.
We've obviously spoken at length there about new schools and how they might be adapted or changed, whatever, in terms of this Futures Trust. In terms of our existing school estate, some of the buildings are sometimes over 100 years old and other ones that were built in the 60s, 70s. What support and guidance can be given to local authorities to make those facilities much more appropriate for those with additional support for learning needs consistently, I suppose, as well?
Well, I think it's worthwhile putting on the record, convener, that the government has supported local authorities to improve the quality of the school estate quite substantially, actually, since 2007. We have improved it, so I think just about over 60% of schools were in good or satisfactory condition in 2007. Today, it's over 90%, and that's because...
Sorry, Cabinet Secretary, we heard from one of the unions, they spoke about it's an ASL cupboard. You know, that's what they have as their space for
I don't understand. Know the specifics of that example, but I'm happy to look at that if the trade union representative is able to share details with me. No child should be getting educated in a cupboard, I used to say, but I think, you know, in terms of the code of practice, there is specific guidance in relation to the suitability of school buildings that's set out.
I mean, some schools are taking and repurposing spaces. I'm trying to get down, to make them the decompression zones, or they're making their walls less rattly and crackly for sound. Sort of adaptation that you can make to make things. Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's the avenue I'm sort of probing around, Cabinet Secretary. Mm-hmm. Apologies.
No, and I think that is set out in the Code of Practice at the current time. We have sought to update, though, I should say, the Code of Practice, so that will be coming, and I think that might help to give further clarity on that, because I think the point you're making, convener, in the range of ways in which schools and local authorities respond to additional support needs, they often repurpose classrooms, and they might therefore seek to update the content of that classroom to meet the needs of their children and young people. So through the updated Code of Practice, there's perhaps opportunity for us to specify more so what that should look like, although it is, I should say, already in the Code of Practice at the current time.
Okay, thank you. Pam Duncan Clancy, sorry.
Thank you. Oh, sorry. Thank you, and I'll be brief. In the updated Code of Practice, is it your intention that you might look to address some of the issues we heard from Sylvia Hockney about support staff who don't have rooms to take young people to, and they're ending up having to provide them with support in stairwells or in some cases in cupboards?
I think that is something we could look at within the Code of Practice. Of course, it depends on the school build that member of staff is working in, but I think that is something we could specify in the Code of Practice in the updated version of it, and there's room for us to do so.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much for that. Liam Kerr, can I bring you back in now, please?
Yes, thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, you talked about the statistics that came out yesterday, and one of the things that I think is particularly concerning is they seem to suggest that there were only 137 behavioural support staff in the whole country, and that's the lowest or the fewest since 2019. And I think they also said that 18 out of the 32 local authorities don't have any behavioural support staff. So, Cabinet Secretary, does that concern you? What's going on and what can be done?
So, yes, it does concern me. What I think is going on is the way in which local authorities measure these members of staff. So we know that we have record numbers of pupil support assistants. That's because, and the data yesterday shows that increase, that's because of this ring fence fund that the government provides. But at the same time, Mr Kerr is right to allude to this challenge in relation to staff that are specified as behaviour support staff. I think some of the challenge here is in the meaning of the job titles. So it may very well be the case that a number of the pupil support assistants that we now have record numbers of in our schools are helping to support with challenges associated with behaviour. They might not have that in their job title, but I think this is part of the challenge. And from memory, it's also something that the Education Committee in the previous Parliament looked at.
Thank you for that. That's a really interesting point, because I take your point about the numbers of PSAs. However, it was a point made earlier in evidence to this committee in other sessions about, are we asking our staff, in this case PSAs, to become more generalists, so a move away from specialists and loading more and more responsibility and indeed specialist responsibility onto other functions like PSAs. Do these statistics in your mind then suggest that that's what's happening? And in your view, is that the right direction to travel?
I think undoubtedly there has been movement, and I think the government has recognised it, which is why we've protected this funding. And it is worthwhile saying that we have been able to increase people support assistance in the last year. But the member makes an important point about specialists, and I suppose this goes back to some of the points Mr Rennie was making at the start of the session around about speech and language. There will always be a role, I think, for specialists in our schools, and I think we need to better understand that. Mr Greer might want to ask a supplementary on this. I know he has a keen interest in this, but there is something about how we can accredit and recognise people who work in these roles, because it is a specialism. And I think this catch-all term, pupil support assistant, sometimes covers lots of different things. And, you know, historically, I think, as I alluded to in my response to the convener, 20-odd years ago, we would have, certainly in secondary schools, specific teams of staff that were tasked with responding to and supporting behaviour, and other teams of staff that dealt with support for learning. Those two roles, over the course of the last 20 years, have almost come together. Now, some would argue educational academics would probably argue, I think as we heard at the behaviour summits actually, that's because we have now a broader understanding of additional support needs and we accept that behaviour is part of that wider challenge. But I think, to the member's point, we need to better understand where it is that behaviour support is needed and where it is that additional pupil support is needed. Those are two different things. It is a matter for local authorities, though, I think, to identify where they need that support and what it should look like. And I would hope that the published behaviour action plan in the next few weeks will help to give some more drive in relation to local authorities' opportunities to help support better behaviour in their schools. And perhaps that looks at the issues that Mr Kerr is talking to. It would be pretty difficult for me as Cabinet Secretary to specify they should have to employ a certain number of behaviour support assistants, but we do specify ring fencing around about pupil support assistants.
And on that specialisation that you talked about then, so what progress has been made in terms of developing career progression and pathways for teachers who do want to specialise in additional support for learning, and indeed the accreditation for classroom assistants that you talked about?
So we have the role of the lead teacher, which I think the committee may have taken evidence on, that was created back in 2021. The lead teacher role, I think, gives opportunities for staff to specialise and stay within mainstream provision too. So, for example, an additional support needs, I think, would be an opportunity for that. The GTCS has also undertaken further work in relation to accreditation on additional support needs. So there are opportunities for staff to specify in that regard too. But I think more generally, what I was trying to rehearse in my response to the convener earlier is that there used to be almost a staffing structure, certainly in secondary schools, that look to support, let's say, behaviour. That doesn't exist in the same way anymore. It's much more, I suppose, to Mr Kerr's point, it's a more general approach that looks at pupil support in the round. But if staff want to specialise, they should be enabled to do so. The lead teacher role allows them to do that. It hasn't been as popular, I think, as we would have hoped, and I'd be pretty pragmatic about that. There are a number of challenges there post-COVID that staff might not be interested in that role or in specialising, but I think I'm keen to work with the teaching unions on how we can encourage that use of the lead teacher role, because that, to me, is the opportunity here.
Grateful. Thank you.
Claire?
Sorry, just to add to what the Cabinet Secretary has said, I think Ross Garrow will be aware of this in terms of the House Agreement as well.
there was a commitment to consider accreditation and qualification for additional support learning assistance. That work has been ongoing. It's been slightly delayed, as you'll be aware, but we're looking to publish the report on that in spring. And a lot of engagement's gone in with pupil support assistance around what that would look like, how that would function, what the reality of that would be in practice, and how they would achieve and access that kind of process of accreditation and qualification. So we can certainly bring that back for consideration too as one of the avenues for professional development.
Mm. Actually got a supplementary from Pam Duncan Clancy, if you don't mind. Thank you.
Thank you, convener. So the data yesterday shows that about in 2013 there was one specialist support teacher for 40 pupils, and that now there is one specialist support teacher for 89 pupils. And the Cabinet Secretary has set out that there is an increase in support assistance. So is it the government's specific policy then to transfer the responsibilities of a specialist teacher and the terms and conditions that come with that onto pupil support assistance? And if so, what will the Cabinet Secretary do about the terms and conditions that come with that?
No, it's not the government's policy. And I think it is worthwhile saying that the statistics that published yesterday did show a slight increase in relation to teachers with ASN as our main subject. So I think, though, we need to be mindful that, and this will be a common theme of all of my evidence, I suppose, to the committee today, local authorities employ our teachers, not the government. So here is a challenge, I suppose, I put back to the member. Should it be for the government then to ring-fence this funding, whether that be for teachers or for classroom assistants? Should it be for the government to direct local authorities and say, this is where you should invest that additionality from Scottish Government? Local authorities right now are choosing to use that additionality to employ record numbers of pupil support assistants. I think that is making a difference, but I don't take away from the role of specialist teachers. I hope the member understands. So there is a challenge here because I don't employ our teachers.
There are 392 fewer specialist teachers now than there were 10 years ago. Mm. And I take the point about the ring-fencing point. The Cabinet Secretary will know I haven't exercised on this particular issue. But I don't think it's acceptable for the government to say we can ring-fence it but then not put money into it. And local authorities, I think, are making really difficult decisions because of the settlement that they have. So we now face a situation where, and if the Cabinet Secretary is saying pupil support assistants are going to be more the way that local authorities will go, and I think they're hugely valuable, will the Cabinet Secretary now accept then that pupil support assistants need to have training and support to do their job? They need to have paying conditions that reflect the size and scale of the job as it has become, and that they also probably need some non-contact time to be able to do the training and risk assessment that's required within that role.
So I think in relation to the ask in relation to training, I suppose that was covered in the response from Claire to Ross Greer and the Bute House commitment in relation to accreditation and support for pupil support assistance, which I accept, and I think we need to support training far better than we do at the current time. There's a disparate approach, I think it's fair to say, across the country, and there are ways in which we're going to support that through that commitment, and we'd be keen to give an update to the committee. It should have been, of course, before the end of last year, but officials have been rather busy with a few other things, so we want to bring forward, though, I think, that important work. I think to Ms Duncan Glancy's point about additional support needs teachers, can we just remember that since 2004, because of the Act, the impetus has been on all teachers to provide a level of additional support need. So all teachers in Scotland should be providing and do provide additional support needs to their pupils. They do that every day. There's still a role, I think, for specialists, but let's remember that within that ring fencing, it's not just about protecting pupil support assistants and increasing the numbers there. Local authorities have also chosen in some instances to use that additionality to employ specialist teachers. That's a decision they have at their disposal. So I suppose that the challenge here that Ms Duncan Glancy puts to me, is it for government to direct them how many specialist teachers they wish to employ in their schools? Is it for government to ring fence it?
I think it's important for government to take leadership on this.
I accept the leadership role, and that's why we ring fence funding for teacher numbers and for pupil support assistants. But the specific of the question is around about specialism. So in accepting responsibility, short of me directing local authorities, which I don't want to do, I'm trying to see where the resolution is to this.
OK, thank you. Liam Kerr still wants to come back in.
Yeah, I just thought it's a really good question from my colleague. And I wonder, Cabinet Secretary, can you help me with something? On the point about local authorities being the employer, and the lack of funds that our local authorities have and how the numbers are changing. What are the salaries, because I genuinely don't know off the top of my head, what are the salaries of a behaviour support assistant and a pupil support assistant?
They will vary by local authority. I don't know them off the top of my head, nor do I have them in front of me. So they will vary by local authority. But I do remember, I'm looking at Mr Greer and Mr Rennie, in the previous Parliament, we did look, I think, at this issue in more detail, and there's variance across the system.
Would you mind possibly getting that information sent in just to give us an idea?
Yeah, happy to do so. And do we collect that information? It would be a matter for local authority. So we can share with you what we have at national level, but it may be that I don't want to direct the committee, but it may be that the committee wishes to write to COSLA on this matter.
Thank you.
Which I think might be more appropriate than government.
Thank you very much for that discussion around that theme. Can I now bring in Bill Kidd? Thank you again.
Thank you, Convener. And Cabinet Secretary, in evidence, joint evidence given to us by Inquire and My Rights, My Say, they said that they continue to hear about many of the long-term negative impacts following the pandemic. And I'm just wondering if you consider there's been enough focus and investment to support children, particularly those with anxiety, to re-engage with learning following the pandemic and the isolation elements, etc., that took place due to that?
I think more generally, and I know the committee's taken evidence on this, we've seen a real uptick in relation to dysregulated behaviour. I spoke to some of the challenge in some of our younger citizens, so speech and language delays. We see in the Behaviour in Scottish Schools research that published in November some really challenging behaviour in some of our youngest citizens. So primary four, age eight, some real challenges with behaviour and relationships that we would not have seen before the pandemic. So I don't think we can say that COVID hasn't made a difference. I think it has compounded challenge that existed in the system prior to lockdown, however, because I think there was challenge previously. We also see gaps in our children's learning. So when we talk about comparing exam results, for example, from the last 4 years to those that existed before the pandemic, I think we need to be really careful. There are big gaps in our children's learning because they were not in school for extended periods of time. And we all, I think, need to accept that. And how the system responds to supporting our young people, I think, is really important. Prior to my time as Cabinet Secretary, the previous Cabinet Secretary worked to provide a package of support, I know, to children and young people before the last examination round with SQA. We also looked at a number of ways in which we could support people online. I think the committee might have taken evidence on this. So eSchool has been very important in that respect, providing digital opportunities. We also have the NELO offer via Education Scotland, which is very strong. And the final point I would touch on is the work that we've been able to do through the SAC programme with virtual head teachers, who in a number of parts of Scotland are working with our care experienced young people to support their learning, but also to support attendance, because we know there's real anxieties in the system. And sometimes virtual head teachers have got a reach that traditional classroom-based or school-based head teachers might not have. So we're looking at different ways of working to enhance and protect the outcomes for these young people who during the pandemic became disengaged from their learning. And I think I have touched on evidence of the committee previously, certainly in Parliament, about evidence that published down south in January from the Centre for Social Justice, which looked at the frayed link between home and family during the pandemic and how that's having a compounding effect on attendance. And again, I hope we go back to this, but we've got real challenges just now on attendance, and I would encourage the committee to look at the local level data, the variance across the system, whereby we have a local authority in Scotland. 50% of young people in secondary are persistently not attending school. That means they're missing 10% of the school year. That's a significant amount of learning. You can't hope to respond to challenges in relation to behaviour or attainment or attendance without having your young people in front of you. So I think these issues that Mr Kidd talks to are all intrinsically linked post-pandemic. And obviously we'll go on perhaps to hear Mr Kidd's views on whether or not that's working. I don't think there's a magic wand we can wave, but the system, we are looking at new ways of working. The virtual head teachers is a good way of exemplifying some of that.
Well, thank you for that. Right, OK, so this one then is just a wee follow-up question, but it might prove to be a wee touch tricky on the basis that just to ask you what your and the government's views are on the flexible or hybrid learning model, which could see pupils choose to learn from home or in school. either pupils or their parents or both working together, making, because it would sound from what you said there that your wish would be that more people would be attending school more often in order to socialise them better, if nothing else, actually.
Well, it improves outcomes for young people if they're in school. So, and I guess that's quite important. You know, I think we need to be really mindful of the role of school. Physically being present in school is an important factor. But there are some young people who we know for attending school can be extraordinarily stressful for them. So there are a range of different ways in which we can support that provision. There has been a move to some level of online provision. For some young people, that might work, particularly for harder to reach young people. I gave the example of the Virtual Head Teachers Network. Engaging with care experienced young people, trying to ensure that they were engaging with school education and attending as well. But I think post-pandemic, that mixed model approach is used by eSchool, for example, through qualifications they're able to deliver. Quite often in that delivery model, and certainly through NELO, young people might be in school and experiencing digital learning, and I think that would be the preference. For some young people, coming into school is still extraordinarily challenging. But I have been in schools and primary schools where head teachers have used members of staff, perhaps a pupil support assistant or others in their school community, to engage directly with a young person and their family, and have been able to, over the course of a number of weeks and sometimes months, encourage that person back into school. And I think that is always to the benefit of that young person.
That's the best direction, and thank you very much for that. Thank you.
And Stuart McMillan, you want to come in on this as a supplementary. Thanks. Welcome. Good morning.
Yes, thank you, convener. Good morning. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Just following on from Bill Kidd's question, I think everyone would agree actually attending school is the best option. If the hybrid model were to be considered and that still wasn't successful with some students, what would you think would be the next kind of option to try to help young people? Because I'm aware, certainly from my own constituency, of some young people who are just not engaging and just don't want to engage.
And I think, I suppose, Camille, to reflect, we've always had a cohort of school refusers. It's not a new feature of Scottish education. It exists in most education systems. So I think, fundamentally, the 1980 Act sets out the expectation that children and young people should be in school. So it's a legal requirement for them to be in school. And I think we should be mindful of that. But there are ways in which local authorities can support young people. So to Mr Kidd's question, we can use virtual head teachers, we can use online approaches. There are outreach mechanisms. Some schools use their PEF funding to employ people to go to young people's doors to help encourage them attend school. That's sometimes part of the problem. So there are a range of different mechanisms that schools have always used to engage people or young people in their education. I don't really see that as being a new feature, I suppose, post-pandemic. The real difference is the move to digital as an option. But it shouldn't really be the first preference option. Attending school is the first preference.
No, thank you.
Thank you very much. Ruth Maguire, now, can I come to yourself? Thanks.
Thank you, convener. Good morning. I suppose, sitting, listening to our discussions this morning, I'm thinking about the parents and the young people that we took evidence from. Firstly, when we were scrutinising colleague Pam Duncan Glancy's bill about transitions, and also for this inquiry. So a lot of stock's been put on the ASL action plan as being the thing that will make a difference to children. Can we hear some examples of the positive difference that has made for children and young people in all settings? I know we've covered some of this in general terms, but I think it's helpful.
Yeah, so there's a number of different initiatives that are being taken forward through the action plan. Some are partway through, some we're continuing to deliver. A good example, and you may have heard of this in your engagement, I think you spoke to the Young Ambassador, Inclusion Ambassadors, is that there are Success Looks Different Award, which is an excellent mechanism that they've developed to celebrate the success of children and young people with an additional support need. So it gives schools, both mainstream and specialist provisions, an opportunity to highlight and emphasise the breadth and depth of attainment that people can achieve. that isn't necessarily recorded in our traditional stats that we might quote and kind of look to within the system. This is a new award that's been in place, well, a couple of years old, so it's reasonably new, but it's actually gaining in prominence and desire in terms of schools who are keen to consider that and use it as a way of supporting some of their children to recognise their attainment. So it's one small step in the right direction for children and young people in terms of the impact, but also raising the awareness amongst the broader school population about additional support for learning needs that isn't solely focused on those with the additional need themselves.
Mm-hmm. OK. Is there anything else?
In terms of the ESL Action Plan? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think that there are a number of actions that we have considered and completed as during the course of the work that we've undertaken. One of the important parts of the ESL Action Plan, it has an overarching there are an overarching recommendation in relation to the Morgan Review, which is about the engagement of children and young people as part of our work. And again, the Ambassador Inclusion Engagement with our team in the establishment of the vision for what children and young people with additional support needs want. Those young people were the people who created and produced that vision. We have published that vision. It sits alongside all of our work in terms of additional support for learning and in the action plan. It is central to our thinking of every single recommendation and action that we take under the action plan. So that point about children and young people's engagement is absolutely at the core of the work that we do around all of the implementation of the action plan. So I think it's embedded throughout. We've obviously given specific examples there of actions that we take, but in considering the needs of children and young people with additional support needs, that's very much part of our approach all the way through our work.
I think just to add, Convener, if there are areas of the action plan that committee thinks are missing, I'd be happy to listen to those in the committee's final report, because of course we're progressing our update on the actions that will publish in the next few weeks. But I think there's an opportunity here for us to make sure that that action plan is actually driving the change that Ms McGuire talked to.
Okay. We've also discussed the challenges that families face in having to navigate systems and get what their children need. Is there something, an example within the ESL Action Plan of work there that has improved communication and engagement between local authorities and families?
There's work pre-existing the ESL Action Plan, we obviously have established the Inquire Service. Yeah. That service is there to provide advice, information, online information, very specific information about parents and carers' rights. The code of practice that we've talked about, the statutory code of practice, the equivalent is the Parents' Guide for Children and Young People. Children in Scotland, who are the managers of Inquire, took the original code of practice and translated it into the Parents' Guide for children and young people. So there's that sort of mirroring of the understanding of those two pieces of information. So that pre-exists the ESL Action Plan. Our action in the ESL Action Plan is about ensuring that those communication methods are as effectively used as they can be. I think you've heard evidence from parents and carers that they're not always able to, they're not connected to the information in as straightforward a way as they could be.
About measuring the effectiveness of the Inquire service that you mentioned?
No, we have that service. The action in the ESL Action Plan is the way that service used, the way that we want it to be. Is there more that we can do to make that better?
Okay. And how do you measure the success of it? How do you know if it's working for parents?
So we collect information, because we have established that service, we collect information from that service about its engagement with parents and carers, how many people have accessed their website, how many parents and carers have used the helpline. All of that information is gathered in BIOS.
But I think those figures?
Yeah, of course. Yeah. I think it's one of the things that we will update in the progress report in due course.
But I think, to Ms McGrath's Santa point, it's quite a cluttered landscape just now in relation to the support available to parents. So one of the actions in the action plan is to simplify what that looks like. Because it's a range, we've got Let's Talk ASN service, of support for children and young people, there's the Enquire service, so I think we need to pull this together so we can signpost parents and actually make sure that they are getting the support they need to prevent, I guess, going back to the point made about the tribunal service, that escalation. And I think right now it's a bit, you know, there's a variety of different ways in which parents and young people can receive support, and it's not always that clear, I think.
Okay.
Thank you. Yes, and I think if we move to questions now from Ross Greer, hopefully we'll dive in around that theme a little bit more.
Thanks, Convener. Yeah, it segues very neatly into this theme. Cabinet Secretary, you've seen in previous evidence sessions that there's been a lot of focus on coordinated support plans, which colleagues will go into in more detail specifically. But as part of that, there's been a lot of discussion around the range of plans that are available to young people, the child's plans, individual learning plans, individual education plans, bespoke plans within local authorities, bespoke plans within schools, etc. I wonder if you could expand a bit more on what the Scottish Government's position would be on taking a more consistent and holistic approach to that, and specifically whether it is actually GRFIC compliant for a child to be in a position, essentially what we are at the moment, where to get the coordinated support plan, you already have to have other plans in place. So you, by default, end up, if you're a child in the position of getting a coordinated support plan, you actually have multiple plans, which to me wouldn't be GRFIC compliant, because GRFIC is about having one coherent plan for each young person. But in practice, kids with the most complex needs have to have multiple plans to access or unlock the support they require.
Yeah, in a moment. I think to Mr Greer's point, this does follow on from Ruth McGuire's point. It's extraordinarily confusing for parents just now. And it's extraordinarily confusing for young people as well, the range of different plans on offer. I think worthwhile, I suppose, rehearsing that the number of CSPs, as Mr Greer will know, has been steadily reducing over time. At the same time, we've seen a real increase in relation to IEPs. So across the board, that shift, I suppose, to IEPs has happened quite organically. To the point Mr Greer puts about GRFIC, I think it's an interesting one. I think the committee also was looking at the compliance of the UNCRC around about some of our work here too. And of course, that's something we'll seek to update the committee on in the action plan update. And I'm happy to take away the point on GRFIC unless Laura wants to talk to that today. There are real challenges here though at the current time in relation to the range of different plans that a young person might have. So we do need to think, I think, set out that more clearly in relation to the action plan with local authorities.
If you were able to write to us about the... Sorry, Laura, were you...
Sorry,
if you could write to us about the GRFIC point, then that would be really useful. On CSPs in particular, so the Cabinet Secretary, you've sat on this committee before where we've taken evidence on this and gone around the houses over and over again on the challenges with CSPs. Last week, though, we had quite a significant bit of evidence that was submitted to us by... ADES and by COSLA representatives around the criteria for a CSP, and specifically the point that the major barrier that they were finding was the requirement that a young person would need at least 12 months of intense support from multiple services, multiple agencies, however it's worded. And what they were finding was young people who everybody agreed actually did need a CSP were unable to get one because that box specifically couldn't be ticked as such. Is the Scottish Government open to revising the criteria for CSPs and this area of the 2004 Act?
I think we are open to revising the specifics on it. Laura, I know, wants to come in on this point, though. We did review, I think, access to CSPs in 2021 on the back of the Morgan Review.
Yes. So the specific point about the criteria for coordinated support plans is, as you have heard, the purpose of a coordinated support plan is to coordinate support from across multi-agencies, and that support requires to be significant and long-term. It is a very, very high standard in terms of the number of children and young people who will meet those requirements. I think there's an opportunity, though, to further clarify the part about multi-agency arrangements, because the Act is very specific in that it is the education authority exercising any of its functions. So that could be the social work function as well as the education function. Because there is provision of support from social work services, that has to be significant and long term. The fact that that's been provided doesn't mean that the criteria isn't met. And therefore, I think there is an opportunity for us to clarify that even further. The place for us to do that, as we've already discussed this morning, is the Code of Practice. Yeah. So we can do that.
One of the points that was made to us in relation to that specifically was the example of mental health support and counsellors, that when the Act was originally drafted, and up until quite recently, the vast majority of that support was provided outside of schools, but because of a recent and welcome Scottish Government decision, it's obviously provided in school, which actually then creates this perverse issue. I'm wondering the extent to which the Code of Practice alone can address this, given, as you said, that the Act itself is really quite specific, which is a point of learning for future, that maybe primary legislation should be a bit vaguer and more flexible to allow for adaptation. But are you confident, I suppose I should direct this to the Cabinet Secretary, sorry, are you confident that we will actually be able to address the issues that have been surfaced by the evidence that were surfaced in the 2021 review through revising the Code of Practice alone, when the underpinning legislation is so specific?
I think, we've already committed to strengthen the Code of Practice in this space, and I know that work's been ongoing since the 2021 review. However, I think to Mr Greer's substantive point, if he's asking me to commit to changing legislation today, I would seek to come back to him on that point.
I seek to expect that before the end of this parliamentary term, given the wider legislative timetable, but there's a challenge here. We've identified what seems like a very specific legislative problem that I think the Code of Practice could result in improvements on, but it won't address the fundamentals, because you can't use Code of Practice to rewrite the law.
Yeah, so if I could write to the committee setting out a timescale on when we're going to strengthen the Code of Practice, of course that's part of the review update, setting out our action. And if committee is minded that legislative changes are what is required, then I will look at that with officials.
Thank you. Thanks, Camir.
Certainly much has moved on in terms of what schools are doing. You've said it yourself, Cabinet Secretary, the schools are now, they stepped up in the pandemic and they're continuing to do that, and they're absorbing much of the services that were provided by health and social care partners in the past. And that is almost giving a veto to some of those young people accessing CSPs. And I think the world has moved on significantly since things have changed, so we are welcoming any sort of refresh or review that you might be able to do under the current abilities. Can I now bring in Pam Duncan Glancy, please? Thank you, Pam.
Thank you, Convener. And it will not surprise the Cabinet Secretary to hear me say that I think that we do need to look at the legislation in terms of plans that are available. I made this point extensively during the non-passage of my transitions bill. And it was highlighted a moment ago that individual plans are on the increase, but they, of course, don't have a statutory basis. And so, before I move on to my substantial question, does the Cabinet Secretary think that there is a need to put some of those plans on a statutory basis to help parents have that right to redress?
I think the member makes an interesting point. Of course, the difference between the two plans, I think, is quite important, because there may be far greater need associated with the statutory plans than those that are not. And the challenge here, I suppose, is how you can measure that difference and still give parents the rights and the young people actually themselves the opportunity. I don't know if this is something we've considered in the past. The 2021 review predates my time.
So I think there have been previous conversations around the balance of planning and the associated dispute resolution in relation to those plans. As Ms Gilruth has already indicated, there are a range of mechanisms available for dispute resolution. They are deliberately set out at different levels, and that's to reflect the different arrangements that are in place. Of course, while our policy view is that the tribunal is the ultimate in dispute resolution, there are a number of ways in which a person can end up taking a case before the tribunal. It doesn't necessarily only relate to planning. There are vehicles attached at each of the levels to enable dispute resolution. I suppose that's why we are a bit concerned about the focus solely being on the tribunal, and therefore the need to make sure that all of those dispute resolution mechanisms are understood.
Probably we'll come into this in more detail. So, but I thank you for that answer. On the point about the committee being made aware that there are a range of services out with education that are required, and the Cabinet Secretary, you've already highlighted this, so I think you understand this, that there are a number of issues like speech and language therapy, CAMHS, counselling, social work services, all of these things are required to be available round a young person. So can I ask Cabinet Secretary, is it your intention that education should be coordinating those services to support children with complex needs?
I think the reality is that education is coordinating those services right now. Certainly from my own experience, mm-hmm. having been in a school not that long ago, it was absolutely education who coordinated services. And that could be really challenging for education who are dealing with lots of other things in the day-to-day life of running a school. So should it be for education? No, I think it should be a shared joint endeavour. And some of the evidence I alluded to, I think, at the start of the session from Audit Scotland talks about how you could actually have a much more a funding approach that brought partners together. And right now, we have quite a disparate approach to that, I think. Education is often leading the charge because education has a young person in school quite often, and they're trying to build the support around that person. They're trying to bring partners to the table. But I know that can be really challenging. And I'm not clear that the sole responsibility should rest with education. I think it should be a joint endeavour, particularly with health, given the number of health professionals who are involved in providing support to some of our most our young people with their most challenging additional support needs. You know, we need a wraparound system that doesn't lean on schools to the extent that they are under such burden to provide not just the kind of pulling together of services, but really the frontline provision. And I think that pressure is often, if I may say so, as a former teacher, granted, I think that pressure is often felt more so by education than by other services.
And so what could you say about the reform and public sector reform in general that you think could help that?
I think there's an opportunity undoubtedly to public sector reform. And I think some of the points that were made by Audit Scotland and I think, was it Speech and Language Therapy
Royal
Scotland?
College.
Royal College as well in this space, about, you know, parents shouldn't be having to have this fight. I just think that speaks to the heart of this, because we've built a system which, for example, we'd see a senior teacher in a school having to pull partners together around a you know, support coordinated for a young person. We've got to put the young person at the centre of it. That is the ethos of GIRFIC. So let's build the support around the young person and not be fighting over budget lines. And the reality of where we are now is that's often what happens. And I think public sector reform will give us an opportunity to drive some of that work forward. We are already starting, I should say, cross-portfolio work with health in a number of different areas. Speech and language is a good example of it, but there are other opportunities for us to bring health to the table. For example, in attendance, and again, happy to share details of this with the committee, Education Scotland are working with Public Health Scotland just now and a number of head teachers on an approach to attendance that is rooted in a public health approach. I think that's really interesting because I think health has got a huge role to play actually in tackling some of the challenges here.
I agree, I think it does. What we've heard in sessions, though, including from the Royal College of Speech and Language Therapists, is that this more consultative approach, as colleagues have alluded to, has basically meant that professionals like speech and language therapists or CAMHS professionals have had to give a bit of input to teachers who are then having to provide speech and language therapy to their pupils. Or in one case, we heard parents talk about how the teachers had to give cognitive behavioural therapy to pupils because there weren't enough psychologists to provide that intervention. In an answer to one of my parliamentary questions, you've said that over the next 3 years, the government will invest in a new programme of work to build confidence and capacity for staff working in early learning and childcare settings and joining up efforts across key public services. So is it now the government's policy then to have this consultative approach in schools and put more workload on teachers?
No, I don't think so. And I think actually what we've heard today, actually, in terms of the role of specialist staff, I've been quite clear that I see a really key role for them in providing support to the profession. I think the points the member makes are really important. I think how we resource that is the challenge. So I've given examples of ring fencing. The member may have other ideas. I actually think, more broadly, if we take a step back from where we are just now, this is about service delivery. How does the system, the whole system, not just schools, respond to a post-pandemic world? How does it deliver education? Because right now, I don't think our approach is working. And I think that's why public sector reform gives us an opportunity to tie budget lines together, to make sure that it's not education mopping up what should be a joint endeavour, and to have more partnership working. So it's not about pushing things on to classroom teachers, absolutely not.
It very much does feel like that, and I know that that's what teachers have told us. And obviously they've got class sizes of 33. In a special school, that's down, the average class size is 6. So class sizes, workload, non-contact time, all of this has to be part of the solution. So I'd like to hear the Cabinet Secretary say something about whether that will be included in the action plan going forward. But my final point on the joined-upness of services, we've got one educational psychologist to about 650 pupils. We've got a budget reduction in mental health of about £10 million. So how can the Cabinet Secretary see all of this joined-up provision working in the way that she describes and not put an extra workload on teachers?
So, I mean, the member makes a number of points about workload and class sizes. I mean, I don't know, Convener, if you want me to talk through all these things, I could be here until 12 o'clock, but let's not pretend that every teacher in Scotland is teaching in a class size of 33. That is absolutely not the case. If you teach a practical subject, for example, your class sizes will be capped, I think, at 20. And, you know, across Scotland, there will be a variety of different class sizes. Workload is an issue I've been working with the teaching unions on because I recognise the challenge here. But workload, again, is a monolithic term that you have to get into and understand, well, what is it we're talking about when we talk about workload? And incidentally, workload in Fife will look different to workload in Dundee because local authorities ask teachers to do different things. So let's be pragmatic when we talk about things generically like workload. And I know the teaching unions like to talk about these things, but we really, to make a difference, need to understand what it is we mean. And one of the things, of course, that we removed in terms of workload were the outcome and assessment standards. Mr Swinney did that, I think, some years ago now, around about the qualifications. We're now looking at, and I know the teaching unions are supportive of, reintroducing a level of continuous assessment. So the workload associated with that, in terms of the new qualifications, will need to be really carefully judged, particularly for secondary teachers. And I'll now segue on to Ms Duncan Glancy's substantive point, which I think was on mental health. I mean, I think we have a positive story to tell in relation to the counselling support we've been able to provide in every secondary school in Scotland that didn't used to exist, and it is now embedded. I think that's important, and it's not teachers that are delivering that support. And actually, I think that model is one we can learn from. The question here, to go back to the original question, is how do we embed that substantive specialist provision where it is needed? And I accept it is needed, and I look forward to working with COSLA on that, because to go back to Mr Kerr's point, this is about having a joint approach, because I as Cabinet Secretary can't direct COSLA, but we need to take leadership at national level. And I think me setting out expectations of the use of specialists is helpful in giving some of that direction, but working with COSLA, whether it be on behaviour, whether it be on attendance or in supporting additional support needs, is how you get change at local level.
Thank you.
Ben McPherson now, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Just on the points that Mr Greer made, the Human Rights Bill may potentially be a vehicle for primary legislative change on some of these matters. Just thought that might be of interest for the record. A general question to conclude. It's obvious that you really care about this issue, and I know that, and appreciate the difficulty of dealing with this and the challenge on resources. You said in your opening remarks about the Morgan Review and that all the recommendations in terms of actions had been accepted, 39 had been delivered, and there's going to be an ESL plan update on the remaining outstanding actions to be delivered. So when do we anticipate that response? How do we track progress? What further engagement is there going to be with COSLA? When this committee provides recommendations from our inquiry, are you open to having quarterly updates on progress on those recommendations? So you said that constituents write to you regularly, and so do mine. What do we say to them about how we're moving forward?
Yeah. So first of all, thank you for the offer of the human rights legislation as a vehicle, perhaps, to update the ASL Act. Obviously, that will be a matter for members to consider. On your substantive question, though, Mr McPherson, so the ESL Action Plan is coming in the next few weeks. I, in discussion with officials, actually head a committee, was mindful that you're probably about to produce your report in the next few weeks, and I want to ensure that plan update listens to the outcomes from this committee. So the timescales associated with that are, to some extent, in this committee's gift. I think it's important that Action Plan update listens to the committee. The last Action Plan update we published was last year, and we will publish by March 26, the full commitment to the entirety, I think, of the Action Plan will be delivered by then. But throughout every year, I think, since the Action Plan was committed to, 18 months, there's been an update. Ms McPherson asked about a quarterly, so it's not been quite as regular as quarterly. I can speak to officials about what we can do to fill the gap, I suppose, between the next update and the 2026 final plan. Claire, did you want to come in on that?
Sorry, just to add in terms of your question around COSLA and engagement, they are co-chair of the project board, so we have a really clear partnership arrangement in place with them. So we're actually delivering the plan in partnership with them, ADES, Education Scotland and a whole host of other key stakeholder members. We meet bi-monthly to discuss the action plan, and just to reassure, I suppose, committee members that whilst we're completing actions and they're turning green as we talk about them in the team, that doesn't mean that they're ticked off and that we don't revisit them. So we're very conscious about this cultural shift we're trying to achieve and the fact that we need to sustain that. So we do revisit them at project board meetings, not all of them because there's a substantial number to consider, but we discuss them regularly to make sure that we're continuing to make progress, that we're starting to see those embed. But there's definitely opportunities to reflect on the progress that's being made at a more regular level.
I just think of all the information and feedback that we've received through this process, and you know, we get it in our constituency caseload, how do we reassure those parents and those communities that we're making progress and do that collectively as a parliament?
Well, I hope the update that we will publish following the committee's report will be helpful to that end, but I'll speak to officials about... I'm just obviously, given that officials and I engage with the partnership boards more regularly than the committee does, it may be that we can send the committee updates every 6 months, for example, on the progress of that work.
And just finally, there are, in my experience, benefits of employers being engaged in all of this consideration, powerful institutions and communities like football clubs. There's a big difference that can be made from a collaborative approach beyond the school setting, which you emphasised, Cabinet Secretary, and just want reassurance that the government's open-minded and proactive in all of that.
Absolutely. I mean, I think this has been a key theme of the committee's evidence, that this can't just be about education responding to the challenge here. So we need that partnership approach from a variety of different partners. I've touched on health today, but I think the point the member makes about the importance of football clubs and local communities is a good one. In the debate we had on behaviour a couple of weeks ago now, I think it was in Conservative time, Brian Whittle gave a very good speech to this end. It's obviously something he's passionate about anyway. But the role of sport in responding to some of the challenges post-COVID is fascinating, and I think an opportunity for us to further pursue. And I know Mr McPherson has a constituency interest in this. I think he's raised it with me in the Chamber previously.
You might get an invitation following.
I look forward to it.
Thank you.
Of the what Mr McPherson avenue was going down there, so we'll leave that with him. But I want to thank you specifically around that helpful comment about your ASP action plan update coming, coordinating with perhaps ours, but that's very helpful in terms of how we'll move our work plan forward. Finally, I've got a question or a supplementary from Willie Rennie.
Well, whilst the tone and I think the approach today, I think, has been very good, I think you understand how serious this is. I think it would be remiss of us not to express the anger, frustration that exists out there. A lot of parents are really angry, teachers are giving up, they've had enough, they feel as if they're on the front line without adequate support. They really feel it. And what was striking for me was the Scottish Children's Services Coalition remarks. And they were hinting at the overall effectiveness of the policy, but also hinting about whether mainstreaming is working at all. But they also then draw the correlation between poorer areas of the country, poorer neighbourhoods, and higher proportions of additional support needs. And something that came out in the absence stats yesterday was that the absence rates in poorer areas. So this is not, you know, this affects government policy in so many different ways, that if we are going to close the poverty-related attainment gap, if we're going to close inequalities, we're going to have to get to grips with additional support needs, not just for the sake of those pupils, but for the sake of the country as a whole and its performance. So I think it's important that you understand that there is a lot of anger and frustration, and whilst today's tone has, I think, been the right tone because it's been serious, there is a lot of anger out there. And my come back to my original point is that I worry that those on the front line, whether it's parents, teachers, pupils, are the ones that are having to suffer with this when we've got our policy that we like,
but actually, if it's not working, they suffer. And I worry about the divisions that are created on the back of that. And I just wonder if you wanted to comment any on the absence stats, on Children's Services Coalition, on anything else on that, just so that people understand that, that you do get it.
Thank you to Mr. Rennie. I mean, I guess, first of all, just to respond to the absence stats. So the measure particularly, and I have mentioned this, I think, convener, the persistent absence stats are really quite shocking. And I would invite the committee to really interrogate those stats, as I have, because we see real regional variation across the country in relation to attendance. But a cohort of young people not attending for up to 20 days of the school year, think about the impact that has on their educational outcomes. I mean, I am really concerned about that measure. And we haven't, as a government, looked at that measure since 2014-15. So we added that measure in last year to give us more data to look at the real substantive problem. The commissioner for the Children's Commissioner in England produced really helpful advice, actually, a report, I think, last year on absence in England. And it contained a number of recommendations. And I think she's also quantified the cost of missing school in relation to academic attainment, you know, positive destinations for these young people. It's all bound up in our wider ambition, and GIRFEC is part of it. And I guess the point, I suppose, Mr. Rennie is saying, we talked about this at the start, I still believe in mainstreaming. I think it is the right approach. But I hear the anger, I hear the challenge. And I suppose, to reassure Mr. Rennie and the rest of the committee, one of the first things I did when I was appointed Cabinet Secretary was go and speak to the teaching profession. And they said, we're not ready for these reports, we're not ready for reform. We need to work with you, we want to work with you, but we need to respond to the challenge right now. So I paused educational reform for a year. We'll bring forward proposals on that in the coming weeks. But every step of the way, whether it's on reforming Education Scotland or the qualifications body or our qualifications, our children with additional support needs have to be at the forefront of that. They are holistically part of our system. They're not that add-on that they might have been in 2004. And I think when the Act was first passed, that's where we were. They are part of our system. They are nearly, in some parts of Scotland, half of our pupils have an additional support need. So we have to get it right for them. And right now, I see and I hear the challenge, and I commit to committee, to working with committee members, but also across government, because this isn't just about education. We need to leverage the power of other parts of government, whether that be health, whether that be justice, in a number of different areas, to respond to the challenges post-COVID.
Briefly, Liam Kerr.
Exact point, because I think that's a really important question that Willie Rennie's posed. The attendance statistics will obviously be a function of much more than the education system. And as an observation, there is a tendency to think very much in silos or to act very much in silos. And you're quite right, Cabinet Secretary, we need to get away from that. So I guess the question begged then is, what interaction have you had on things like the attendance statistics with other portfolios, particularly in the light of that report you mentioned from last year?
So on attendance specifically, I receive, I think when I was first appointed, weekly updates. There are fortnightly updates, in relation to attendance. And I think in the first few weeks, and we have discussed this certainly in the Chamber, convener, touched on the variance in relation to certain year groups after the pandemic. So we were seeing dips in year groups that were transitioning during lockdown, whether that be P7 or the kind of PGE transition to senior phase. And we, at that time, were of the view that these young people had really important periods of their education disrupted and then found it very hard to re-engage with the system. So last year, I commissioned Education Scotland to undertake some further work on absence. They published national guidance on this that the committee may be aware of on attendance in November. We then published further data in December, which showed that school absence across the board was at record low levels. And I think that's important for the committee to understand. This new measure we've introduced is about persistent absence. So that's 10% in a school year of, I think, 190 days. So about, let's say, 20 days a year missed of education. It's a big chunk to lose out of your education. In terms of engagement with other portfolios, I haven't specifically engaged with other portfolios on attendance, but I have on behaviour, for example, and on a number of other educational issues. And I will be engaging with my colleagues on this issue because, of course, it isn't just about school.
Thank you very much, and I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary and her officials for their time this morning. This concludes the public part of our proceedings, and the committee will now move into private to consider our final item on the agenda this morning. Thank you very much.